Hello, everybody. Welcome to Elite Wine TV. Hello, everybody. Welcome to Elite Wine TV. I'm your host, Mark Fusco, here for another edition of the show. So, more Somm Select, more French wine. Now we're going Burgundy. We have white and red Burgundy to hop into. So, let's just get right into it. It's like October right now, right? Should be. Halloween's coming up. Sorry. All right, so... what do we have here? As I didn't put it in front of the camera. So we have here the 2013 Michel Sarrazin and Brothers. It's Fils, I don't know, Les Grognots. So this is a white Burgundy, so in other words, Chardonnay. Paid $29 from Somm Select for the bottle. And let's kind of talk about this. The winery is, or the Chateau, Domaine, whatever, is in a little town called Jamblay, okay? And let's say they said it's a little hamlet of just 500 residents, southwest of Givry. So this is a Givry wine. And... also, my notes here. Givry was the source of French King Henry IV's favorite wines. That's what that thing says. Yes, basically, Henry IV said, these are awesome wines. I think that's what the French inscription or French saying on the front of the label says. The family stays in the heart of Burgundy in Chalonnais. 30 kilometers south of Beaune. It says these date back to the 17th century. I'm assuming that the vineyards or the estate dates back to the 17th century. It was developed by Michel Sarrazin, who took over from his parents in 1964 and started bottling the Domaine. Both Guy and Jean-Yves' son joined him in 1986. And 1992. All right, so the estate spread over 35 hectares in the Appalachian. So, all right, so let's talk about Givry. So you have Givry and Gevrey-Chambertin, okay? So this is Côte Chalonnais is southern-ish part of Burgundy, whereas the Côte d'Or and the Côte de Beaune are the northernmost part of proper Burgundy, where it has the Pinot Noir and the Chardonnay. And then you have Chablis, that's another redheaded stepchild, okay? Anyway, so it's produced in the communes of Givry, Dracy, Les Forts, and Jamblay. And they may produce red and white wines, so Pinot Noir and Chardonnay. Red wine dominates with almost 80%. There are 27 premier cru vineyards within Givry AOC, but no Grand Cru. This is not a premier cru, and the AOC was created in 1946. The brothers inherited the wine bug from their father, a pioneer in the hills of Jamblay, who encouraged his sons to explore the limits of winemaking beyond the town's small borders. Let's see. Yeah, I'm not going to read the rest of it. Basically, it's a family operation. These guys are got their hands in everything. Okay. So, again, golden color, right? Almost as golden as that Sauvignon. Now, I would not confuse this for the Sauvignon, right? But I do get a little bit of peach on it, which is what I'm supposed to get from the Beaujolais, right? Almost like peach skin. That's about it. Kind of peaches and not much else. Very apple-y. Like, really apple-y. But there's a bit of, I won't say creaminess, but a bit of, almost creaminess to it. I don't know if this went through malolactic fermentation. If it did, it might have been what they call a partial malo, because you really still get the apple flavors really dominate the wine, but there feels like there's a smoothness to it. But there's definitely some acid, good acid to it. So this could be something where it may have gone through some partial malate, or it could be that the oak treatment is giving you that sense of creaminess or vanilla type of quality. It's not really vanilla, but could give you that smoothness to it. It's a solid Chardonnay. I'll be honest, I've had New World wines that kind of taste like this too. I don't get any minerality. I don't get any chalkiness. I don't get any, stoniness out of it. Then again, we're not drinking Chablis either. But there is a bit of fullness to it. I'm trying to avoid to use the word creamy because it's not really creamy. I don't want people to think I'm getting that, any of the lactic acid, but there's a touch of that type of sensation. I would definitely identify this as Chardonnay, but I could easily think that this was a Chardonnay from New World that was made in a Burgundian style. So it feels like there's a little bit of heat to it, but then again, I'm drinking this at totally room temperature. It's only 30% alcohol, so it's not like it's super hot alcohol-wise. Put a little chill to this. This is totally refreshing. Put it with a salad, fruit salad. Put it with probably pretty much most seafood. Long-term viewers know I don't like seafood, but I understand why seafood goes well with certain wines. It's got some good acid to it. It's not like that razor-sharp acid, but my mouth is watering. Okay, so it's got pretty decent acid to it. It's a good wine. It's $29. It's definitely worth $29. It's not overly priced, at least, through Somm Select. I don't know what its other retail price could be, but if you paid a few bucks more, it's not like you're getting taken for a ride. It is good quality wine. Chardonnay sometimes, most time for me, is not something like, the Sauvignon was like, wow, I want to try it. I want to drink all this. Chardonnay is kind of like, yeah, okay, it's Chardonnay. It's good, but I like other stuff. I don't want to totally ignore, white Burgundy, because, white Burgundy is really good. It's really good juice, man. And everybody, like all my Somm friends, just they see white Burgundy, the taste is, they go, whoop. And I'm like, yeah, it's good. And these people are like thinking it's the best thing since Pinot Noir. Oh, wait a minute. So, but it's a good wine, and I don't want to make light of it, because it's definitely a good wine. If you like white Burgundies, you will like this wine. You will like this wine. I mean, it's only 2 years old, not even, well, yes, it's barely 2 years old. So, and not that white wines you know, typically are, you know, 5 and 10 year out, but it has enough acid. If you wait maybe another year, it probably would be better. I mean, white Burgundies, you know, the thinking is that they tend to age better than, say, you know, Chardonnays from California, but you know, it's drinking just fine right now. So you get a little chill to it. You drink it, you get the right food, you know, hot summer day or Indian summer, you know, like, what is it? It's always hot in September in Napa Valley, right? You know, I'm hoping, this is October now, so I'm hoping that all the wildfires are done with. I mean, God, I hate seeing that stuff. But it's good wine. It's not my favorite grape necessarily, but I still drink lots of Chardonnays. I've had some really good Chardonnays, and don't get me wrong. And this is good. But I guess I got blown away by that Sauvignon the last episode that I'm just like, I probably should have had this first. I couldn't figure out which show I was going to do first, so I'll just finish it with this one. But it's good, worth $29. If you see it, buy it. You're not going to be disappointed if you like white Burgundies. It's good. All right, so let's move on to wine number two. All right, so the next wine, I think this is the most expensive of the six wines I reviewed tonight on three different episodes. just in case somebody caught, this is the first episode they caught and they don't know what I'm talking about. All right, so we have the 2010 Domaine Harmand-Geoffroy Gevrey-Chambertin on Jouise, J-O-U-I-S-E. I really wish I had Fabian or Ceci here to coach me through all this French. Or Peter Wasserman. Dude, yeah. Côte de Nuit. So, we're at Côte de Nuit. And, which Gevrey-Chambertin was part of Côte de Nuit. All right, so, family farm originated in the late 19th century, which to date covers about 9 hectares. The average age of the vines is about 50 years. The oldest is 85. The son of a diplomat who spent his childhood in London, Gerard Harmand, took over the running of the family estate in Gevrey-Chambertin in the early 1990s. Under his direction, the domaine has risen through Burgundy's league table to a firm place in the premiership. Can you tell somebody is from England who wrote that? Anyway, he understands that the wine should offer a sense of place, which I thought all French winemakers knew that. I mean, that's what the whole word terroir means. But they can be inaccessible to the newcomer. Yeah, I should have read the rest of that. Anyway, in light of this, he aims to make wines that are both faithful to their specific vineyard origins while possessing some freshness of texture and charm. Each vineyard is done separately. It says, constantly tasting to determine how much pigage is required. I had to look up pigage. Basically, it's the foot stomping. And what sort of oak should we use, blah, 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 blah. So they're constantly, they're basically they do everything separately by vineyard instead of just shoving it all together. They use traditional cultivation. Looks like they try to be as organic or green as possible. Let's see. This particular wine is made from vines that are between 60 and 80 years of age. The parcel sits beneath the side of Clos Pierre, and like its relative neighbors, Mazy Chambertin is a wine of finesse and elegance with silky tannins and a more openly fruity approach. The domain owns a bit more than a hectare of Anjouise, making this one of the more important cuvées of the domain. And the people that I got this from, they produce, I mean, they purchase about 75 cases. For them, I'm sure more than 75 cases come into the United States. Unless that's the importer. So But anyway, it's not a huge production wine. Oh, did I mention it's $72 guests per bottle? All right, so if I was doing a blind tasting, I stuck my nose in this, I'd be like, yes, it's Burgundy. And it's not Burgundy in the sense of like, it's just like a bunch of barnyard, you know, it's not a bunch of crap in my glass. But you can tell that it's Pinot Noir and it's Burgundy. I mean, you might maybe just on first smell go, it could be Oregon, but no. I mean, there's definitely a combination of earthiness and fruit to it, but I would probably take this first smell to Burgundy rather than Oregon or anywhere else. It checks all the boxes for a really good Burgundy. It really does. So this is what sucks. The third of the three episodes are wines from a region that is honestly not my favorite. It's not that I don't like it, but there's other areas of the world I find more interesting and just do it for me better. But I wouldn't really equate it to country music. Because I like Burgundy better than I like country music when you do the musical reference. But with country music, like, I don't really like country music at all. Not really. I mean, there's a couple songs here and there that are kind of cool. But I can recognize good quality music when it's made. Whether it's country or any other type of, or opera. No offense, Keck. I don't like opera. I'm not saying there aren't any good operas or I haven't appreciated them. But as a genre, it doesn't do it for me. But because I have my musical background and training, I can tell you whether a song or a piece is well written, well produced, well performed, well played, or whatever. So when it comes to Burgundies, whether it's white or red, I can appreciate what they are. And there are Burgundies out there that I'm like, wow, this is awesome Burgundy. And I have other Burgundies like, yeah, they're all right. You know, this is a pretty good Burgundy. Like, I can tell it's done really well. I mean, it's $72, and we're getting up there, man. I mean, this is not a bottle of wine I would probably rush out to buy, okay? Personally, because of the price. Now, if this was priced less, it probably wouldn't be this good, okay? But if it was priced less, I'd be like, okay, cool. It's just a matter of Pinot Noirs from Burgundy. And Pinot Noirs in general tend to not be my favorite wine, so I'm not looking to spend $70, $80, $100 on a bottle. Doesn't mean I won't appreciate them when I'm drinking them. So with that said, this is a really good bottle. If you like Burgundies, if you want something like this, and this has some muscular, musculature, whatever. It's got a little bit of heft to it, okay? Which it's kind of like how I like Pinot Noir. In general, so it's really good. So I'm trying to justify why I just did a big, you know, critique of Burgundy in general. It's nothing wrong with this wine. It's good. $72. It's pricey for the retail side of things, but I mean, it's not like it's 10 grand for, you know, Romani Conti. Okay. We're not drinking DRC here, but we're drinking a very high quality, Domaine from Gevrey-Chambertin. It's got a little bit of extra body to it. It's got good fruit flavors, not over the top. It's got that balance of fruit and earthiness. Maybe it's a little heavier on the earth side, which is totally fine by me. It's got a bit of acid, not much on the tannins. Like, it doesn't really coat the tannins. It checks all the boxes. Like, if you pay $72 and you're into Burgundies, you're not going to be disappointed. You're probably gonna be like, Fusco, what are you talking about, man? This is awesome wine. Okay. So it's good. It's good. And this is going to be a wine where I'm probably going to enjoy it better with food when I'm not in a analytical mode. I'm more relaxed and watching some TV or having a dinner with somebody. And this is in more that what wine's supposed to be, like supposed to be something shared with in a social situation, not put under a microscope. This kind of looks like a microscope, right? Then that is probably where I'll enjoy this wine a lot more, rather than just being like super analytical about it. And also, I'll be honest, Burgundies tend to grow on me as I drink them. You know, as far as a single sitting or a bottle, I tend to kind of go, you know, these are good wines, and I need to reckon. And trust me, 6 years ago, I'd be like, yeah, okay, whatever. You know, over time, I've gotten to appreciate Pinot Noir as a grape way more than I used to, because I guess it was a grape I just didn't quite understand. I didn't get it. There's a finesse to these grapes. Just like Riesling, there's kind of a finesse to them. So when you're first starting out, yeah, you recognize that they're probably good and everyone tells you they're great. You're kind of like, yeah, okay, whatever. I like this one better, you know? But over time, I force myself, I don't want to say force, but I seek out Burgundies because I really want to wrap my head around it. I want to be at the point where I'm like going, these are freaking awesome wines and you should drink them type of thing. I'm at the point of, they're really good wines and if you like them, you should drink them. But I'd rather probably drink something else, like over here. But I'm not going to turn this down at all. If you offer this to me, I'd be like, yeah, man, it's good. And I wouldn't be like, you know, talking out of my ass. I'd be like, this is good, all right? And I look forward to both of these wines. I look forward to drinking these later. This is why I love the Corvin, because I can come back to these when I feel like drinking, when I'm like, you know what, a good Burgundy is what I need right now. We're having something for dinner that a Burgundy will go with rather than, you know, Three Palms Merlot or some Cab from California or a Rioja or whatever, Italian wine. These are the right wines to put with it, right? So Corvin is why I have the Corvin for the show, but so that when I drink these wines later, I don't have to try to drink them within a week, because these wines would be wasted if I couldn't drink them right now. It would be a waste. It'd be a waste of money, and that's why you should get this. $300. They're available in a lot of wine shops around the country. You can order that. You can order it from them. You can order it for Amazon. I should put a link from an Amazon store. Maybe somebody will buy one and I'll make like a dollar from it. It's good. I'm looking forward to drinking these in a more relaxed situation and actually enjoying them better. Anyway, $72. And it's not an unreasonable amount of money for this. I've had a lot of wines in this price range and it just matches up to them. So while I said the comment, look, I'd rather pay less. Well, of course, we'd all rather pay less for everything, right? It's just that I just don't normally spend a lot of money on Burgundy in general. And I have gone out to restaurants and I'm like, a Burgundy is what we need to have. And restaurant price-wise, this is closer to anywhere from $130 to $180, depending on the restaurant, what the markup is and what they paid for it wholesale. You know, this would be kind of on the upper end of what I would spend on a Burgundy or on any wine, not just Burgundy, any wine. You know, working in fine dining, I found that I now will go north of $100 a little more often. But getting closer to $200 is kind of like, I don't know, man. It's a lot of money. So, but this would be kind of on that high end of like, yeah, since I know who they are now, I've had it, I'd be like, you know what? If I had to choose between this and something else, and this was more expensive, and the something else I've never had before, I would buy this. How's that? It's an endorsement. I would buy this because I know what I'm getting, and I know how much I'm paying, and I know the quality of it. Whereas if it was something I've never had before, and it's even like $20 less or $30 less, I might be like, yeah, you know what? I like this wine. It was good. So there you go. All right, that's going to do it for this episode. Look for new episodes coming up soon. Hopefully I didn't get slack and I actually recorded some before this one got put out, or the week it got put out, so I can have more ready to go. Halloween episode should be coming up. I'm hoping and praying that the wines I found a few weeks ago, as in a few weeks ago from this episode, they contacted me and they sent me some wines, or I was able to buy them from somewhere. If not, I hope I find some really cool wines to theme out for the sixth Halloween episode. All right, that's going to do it. Click the links above to frame me up. Hit the donate button over there to send me some ducats so I can spend more money on great Burgundies. And leave comments below here or YouTube or whatever. And we'll see everyone again next time. Do 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 do